everybody hear us okay? Can you guys back there hear me okay? So we are going to use the mics for the live stream. We are live streaming this on YouTube and online so that Charlotte and some of the people that couldn't be here in person can participate. They can watch it online and participate. So in a little while, so I'm going to wear a mic. We're not miking the room. The mics are strictly for the internet feed. So in a little while, we're going to give people an opportunity to share. And we're going to ask you to come up here to share so that the people online can hear you. Because if you stand back there in the room and just talk, the people that are watching online will see your mouth moving, and that's about it. And so we're going to, we'll fix the mic to adjust for you. So I'm glad you guys are here. My name is Mike Waldrop. I'm the lead pastor here at Fellowship. I've known Steve and Debbie and Sean for a long time. I'm not quite sure how long, but Sean was a lot smaller. So probably 3 or 4 years old, I guess. Two when he started here? Okay. So however old he is now, minus two is how long I've known him. Known the family. Debbie works for us here in the office, and we appreciate our relationship with Debbie and Steve, and Steve does huge work around the church and really helps us out a lot, so we're value that relationship, and we're glad you guys are here today. I know a lot of you traveled a long way to be here, and I know it means a lot to the family and to be able to see each other and have this time together. So as we start, if you would join me, I'd like to pray as we begin. Father, we ask for the presence of your Spirit. We ask for you to make yourself known to us today as we gather to remember Susan, a friend and a mom, grandmom. We ask that you would bring to mind the good memories and the good things and the blessing of life that it was with her. We pray you would give us hope and that you would give us comfort, as it's always hard to say Godspeed to those we love. So I commit our time to you, and I ask your presence. I ask you to make yourself known. Move among us as we share today in the name of Jesus. Amen. So I spent quite a bit of time with Charlotte on the phone and email. And if you guys have ever gotten email from Charlotte, I hope you're watching, but she sends comprehensive emails. And so, but just coming together and looking at who Susan was and looking at her history. So I'm going to share with you sort of a life history. It's not sort of, it's a life history that we talked through, and then give you guys an opportunity to share some of the more personal memories. But Susan, and I found this fascinating because, you know, as far as I've known, Steve and Debbie and Sean, I thought they were Texans. I had no idea they were from another country. But Susan was born in Boston, Massachusetts on February the 21st of 1927, and then died here in Pearland last November, on November the 17th of 2022. Her parents were Howard McGregor and Jane Olive Tuttle. And talking to them, I found out her dad was the president of the National Casket Company, which was the only funeral supply company in the United States at that time. And I thought, man, that was pretty impressive, you know? That's people dying to make you a success. Okay. Sorry, I'm a dad, I'm a granddad. I've just got more dad jokes. None of them are any good, but they just pop out sometimes. But I did think that was a really cool thing. That was a very impressive kind of tidbit of information about Susan. I also found out she was originally named Patricia, and that her parents, yeah, you didn't know that either, did you? Yes, that they named her Patricia when she was born, and that was the name they submitted on her birth certificate. But then they changed their mind, and they called her Susan, but they never went back and changed the birth certificate. So later in life, she was going to get a passport, and they had to get a copy of her birth certificate and submit it, and it said Patricia. And she's like, what's going on? And then finds out at that time that her mom and dad had named her Patricia, then changed her mind and renamed her Susan. And she had gone through her whole life as Susan, not realizing her birth certificate said something completely different. And so she continued to be Susan, even though her birth certificate said Patricia. But she was christened as Susan at the First Parish Congregational Church in Wakefield, Massachusetts. And it was a church that dated back to 1644. So old time up on the East Coast, being part of the history of the nation. She was an avid reader, and that was another thing. They lived in Wakefield, Massachusetts, in a four-story pink house. And said she had an extensive library. Her parents had this big library, and she read all the time. And then Steve throws in there, oh, yeah, they had a signed copy by Mark Twain of The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. And I'm like, wow, where is it? And that gave another conversation, but anyway, we don't know. But she was the youngest of six children. She spent a lot of her early childhood in Oneida, New York, had a Canadian au pair. And as the youngest, she was cared for by the au pair and watched her older brothers and sisters grow up and leave the nest one at a time as they went off to boarding schools and to colleges. Susan followed her older sister Janie's footsteps, and when she got old enough, went to a prep school in Troy, New York called Emma Willard, and from there to Maryland College for Women in Baltimore. Which these were all new names for me. I know UT and A&M, and other than that, I didn't know there were other colleges. But she came home for the weekend one weekend and had to stand in for a blind date with her brother's best friend. And on that blind date, she met a man named Herbert Franklin Griffith, who was a Navy pilot and was described as a handsome Navy pilot. And so they got married on September the 3rd of 1948 and then spent their honeymoon in Nantucket. So many interesting things. They loved music, and they loved to go to nightclubs and dance together. And I thought, well, that's cool. A lot of people back in the 50s, you know, that was entertainment. Except Herb and Susan went to Harlem to nightclub because they really liked the black community's music. And the Ella Fitzgerald and that kind of music. And so I was like, that was pretty gutsy. That's pretty cool kind of thing that she was that kind of adventure-loving person that would go out and do, go to those kind of things. And just her and Herb had a lot of fun and did a lot of that. And then Herb died in 2015, and they had been married almost 67 years when he finally passed. They had four children, Charlotte, Scott, Stephen, and Ben. And Charlotte and Scott came along while they lived in Boston. And with the addition of those two to the family, they said the house was no longer big enough, so they built another house and moved to Lynnfield, Massachusetts in 1951, and then later to Norwalk, Connecticut. Steve came along in Connecticut, and again, interesting stories, because I don't think about hurricanes in Connecticut, but they said that part of the family lore was that while they lived there in Norwalk, Susan had three children under six, and they went through two back-to-back hurricanes. They lost power for days on end. The creek behind the house flooded, said it came right up to the back door before it started to subside. And so that's a pretty exciting kind of, you know, being a mom with three kids and no electricity and a flood. And it was not just a little flood. There were lives lost. This was back in, I think, 1955. And if you go back and Google that, you'll find out that there were a lot of people killed that died in that flooding. So it wasn't just a minor little deal where we're stuck without electricity. They were stuck during that time. And yet Susan managed the house and the kids and kept everything together and just did what she did. After Connecticut, they went to Westbury, New York. And in that, in New York, they got real involved in the Methodist Church. And said Susan then became an actress in the church plays. They played in bridge tournaments, and the bridge tournament, the love for bridge tournaments, came up later here in Pearland. And there's another little something I'll share in a minute about that. They went in bowling tournaments and just were very invested, very active in the church socially and in the community. And at that time is when Ben was born, was during that time. So because of Herb's work, the family moved pretty regularly, and I have a detailed dated list of, and y'all guess where I got it, Charlotte, of all the places they lived and how long and when, and it's really pretty interesting. It was very interesting to me to see how much they moved and the different kind of things they did, but what impressed me was that with all of these moves, a lot of time Herb was at work, and it was Susan that was packing up, getting them moved, getting them into a new house, getting them resettled, getting the kids re-engaged with the community and the schools, and all of those kind of things. So they went, he worked in Washington, D.C. and New Jersey, and she moved the family to Mount Airy, thank you. I'm a sight reader. I don't sound things out, so yeah. in Pennsylvania in 1962, and then in 65, they moved to Crab Meadow, Northport, New York. And while they were there, they built what they considered a dream home on Eaton's Neck on Clamshell Lane in Northport. And it was a dream home on waterfront property at Duck Island Harbor. And waterfront property and cabins and dream homes was another theme that seemed to follow Susan through life, because that wasn't the first and last dream home they built. They built two or three dream homes or cabins on lakefront or waterfront or beachfront property because the water and the beach was a big deal. I can't tell you, it is not politically correct to tell me what Steve called the weekends on the beach. But evidently that was, the brothers are pointing fingers up here at each other. another thing that, golf, I have a detailed list of all of the country clubs in which you guys played golf with your mom as well. In Massachusetts and New Jersey and Northport. But the beach was the big deal. Weekend excursions to the beach. Susan gathering all the kids, packing up all the paraphernalia for surf and sun, getting everybody together, and getting them off to the beach for the weekend. Whether on the East Coast or in Canada or when they moved here in Texas, they owned some kind of a beach house or lakefront house that became the family gathering place. That was kind of where people went for holidays and weekends and excursions. Cape Cod, Martha's Vineyard, the Hamptons, Jones Beach, the Outer Banks of North Carolina, you name it, and the guys, they've been there to the beach for a weekend, which is pretty cool. Some pretty neat things. Susan was a very avid swimmer, accomplished swimmer, and just was willing to pack up all the stuff and do that. That was her thing, to go to the beach with the kids. About 1972, Charlotte and Scott and Steve had all left home, and that left Ben and Herb and Susan, and they had to move to Ontario, Canada. So Scott and Steve, you know what's coming. Okay. Scott and Steve came back home to help Ben. No, I said Ben. I said Scott and Steve came home to help Ben, who was still at home, to move to Canada. And they had an old Oldsmobile, and Steve had an old van, and they loaded up four dogs and a cat and all four guys to get in this car cars and caravan up to Canada. Well, in the meantime, Susan flew to Canada to meet them there. So she was at the house that they were moving into, and it was over the Christmas holidays, and it was snowing like crazy and drifts up in the yard. So the moving van with all the big stuff got there and backed into the front yard, but because of all the snow, got stuck. So Susan is there by herself, and of course this is in early 70s, no cell phones, they didn't have a landline yet, and she's stuck there by herself with the moving van stuck in the snow. Well, Steve, being a college student and not having a quite reliable van, experienced a total cratering of the van motor. So they had to leave the van, take everything out of the van, put it in the Oldsmobile, rent a trailer, hook the trailer up to the Oldsmobile, and everything that was in Steve's van, they put in the trailer. So now they've got an Oldsmobile and a trailer, four dogs, a cat, and four men. So they got to the border to come in to go into Canada, and it didn't look suspicious at all during a snowstorm. So the Canadian guards, he said they were very professional and very gracious. They weren't hostile or anything, but they were puzzled and talked to them, and they're looking at these four men, and somewhere between New York and the Canadian border, Herb had gotten fed up with the cat because the four dogs and the cat in the car with the four men were not doing well. So Herb had taken the cat and stuck it in the trailer. So they get to the border, and the border guards are questioning them. Well, we're moving into Canada. Here's what's going on. The border guards are like, okay. Well, do you mind if we look in the trailer? And Herb's like, go ahead. So the border guards went back and they opened the door to the trailer, and there was a quite hostile feline that greeted them, and they took one look at the cat and closed the door and said, go on through. In the meantime, Susan's at the house. They're 24 hours later than they told them. Just she was distressed by the time they got there. So that was... but yet, you know, they unpacked and everybody was distressed. Yes. One of those stories that will live on and, you know, probably get bigger as it goes. You know, the drifts are going to get deeper and the cat's going to get larger, you know. But that was one of those moving stories that Scott and Scott and Ben and Steve obviously were like, oh, you would not believe what happened to us on one of our moves. And poor Susan up there by herself, waiting on them to get there until everybody finally got there. And obviously, they got there and unpacked, and things went well. They lived in Canada for a while, bought another lake home in the Muskoka area around Lake Leonard. And while they lived in Canada, Susan, again, got very involved with the community. She opened up a boutique called the Pheasant's Feather Boutique. She sewed for it. She sewed clothes and sold clothes. You know, when you're Texas, those two words sound a lot alike, but she did a lot of clothes, made rosin art figures, did all kinds of crafts, got into gourmet cooking. Let's get that right. And while they lived in Canada, I was right the first time, gourmet shopping as well. So you got to gourmet shop if you're going to gourmet cook, right? So, and I think during this time while they lived in Canada, then Scott got married back in Northport, New York. Now, while they were in Canada and through this shop and all of her friends, they were always dog people. She loved dogs. As is evidenced by the fact they had to take four of them with them into Canada. But she met some people and became really good friends that introduced her to the business of dog breeding. And so they bred English short-haired pointers. They bred miniature red poodles, which I don't know what that is. But they kept about 30, they raised about 30 puppies. They kept Damon and Yankee and Blackjack, but one puppy named Lua was the love dog or something like that, that she really, really liked. So they got into raising dogs while they were there. She had a boutique while they were there. So Susan was not the kind of person that just moved and went, here we go again, and sat back. She got involved. She did stuff. She was energetic. She was artistic. She acted in church plays. I mean, bridge tournaments, the whole mess, that everywhere she went, there was energy and activity. In about 79 or 80, then they moved down to Pearland until Herb retired in 87. Then they moved back to Cape Cod, and then they moved back to Texas in 96 and lived on Lake Londa Lynn near Livingston. And they lived up there till Hurricane Rita, which, if you are in this area, that is another distinct memory, was when Hurricane Rita came through here. And at that point, they moved away from the lake and moved down into Atascocita and Humble. Well, Herb died in 2015, but before he died, he and Steve had a conversation, and he made Steve promise that he would move his mom down closer to them where she could be cared for. And Steve, being Steve, said, absolutely, we'll make sure mom's taken care of. But it took 2 years to convince mom to move. Mom wasn't having any of it. Susan's like, I'm fine. But she finally, as she was getting older, had fallen several times. And so Steve got her to move down here. While she was here, she lived in several different places, some assisted living, some nursing homes, some apartment kind of things. But a few years ago, she's 90 years old, she's fallen. She's now in a nursing home recuperating and finds out the nursing home has a weekly bridge game. And so she decides she's going to go play the weekly bridge game. But she didn't play it and stay in that weekly bridge game very long because of the old people that were in it. Now, she's only 90. But she said it was no fun because the other old people in the nursing home couldn't remember whose turn it was or how the game was progressing. So she got frustrated and bailed out of that, just like, we're not going to play bridge. And in the meantime, they've called her Card Shark Susie because she was the one that was sharp and kept up with the game and was dealing with and winning all the games, basically because they couldn't remember that they were playing the game. She lived a long life. She was active. She was bright until the very end. She never lost it. Her mental facilities stayed sharp. She was a character, and she did a lot, and she moved a lot, and she lived a lot of places. She spent a lot of energy. She invested a lot in you guys. She leaves her daughter, and if I hope I get everybody. If I don't, please forgive me. She leaves her daughter, Charlotte Turner, and grandchildren Lindy, who passed in 83, and Alexa, her husband Andrew, and three great-grandchildren, Scott and Debbie, and some grandchildren Greg and wife Tina, Jennifer, her two children, Susie's great-grandchildren, Scott and Deb's son Andrew, Steve, his wife Debbie, and their son Ben, and Ben and his wife Liz, and their daughter Raven. And I am sure there are more cousins, nieces, nephews, grandchildren that I have left out. But she leaves a big family that's very active, very sharp, and that has benefited from all the investments of Susan Griffith. She was predeceased by both of her parents and all five of her siblings, Greg, Katrine, Forbes, Janie, and Philip, died years before, and Susan was the last one to pass. So that gives you a big picture view of Susan, but I'm going to sit down and y'all can listen to someone else talk. As Scott and Steve, I think, are going to come and share some of their memories and the legacy of their mom. And then if you have a special memory, if you have something that you would like to share with us, please do. But please come up here to do it and speak into the mic so that the people that are watching can hear and enjoy your memories as well. So Steve or Scott, I don't know which one of y'all are going to start.
Testing, okay. I guess my story is going to be about one of the travels I did with my mother. A lot of travel stories. brothers, but by myself. One time, it was I was living in Canada, and I decided to move from the east side of Canada to the west coast. I went from Ontario to British Columbia, and actually, I left my younger brother there because he was the last survivor of the Canadian regime. But mom and dad lived in Cape Cod then, so I went from I left my job in Toronto, and I packed up my 74 Monte Carlo, and drove to Cape Cod. Went to pretty much the Atlantic Ocean, and picked up my mom, because I don't travel anywhere. You know, you got to travel with your mom when you go by yourself. But I also had a motorcycle there, at Scott's house, so he helped me load the motorcycle on these little rinky-dink rings on the back of the Monte Carlo. So I drove from Cape Cod back up to Toronto, and from there we traveled all across Canada in this Monte Carlo with a motorcycle on the back and a tent in the trunk. And mom and I camped and moteled across Canada for, it was probably a 5-6 day, I don't remember how long it was, it seemed like an eternity. My poor mother having to put up with me, because some of you have traveled with me, and as most men, when you're driving on a trip, you just want to get to the next place. You don't want to sightsee, you don't want to do anything. And here's my poor mother wanting to stop at every possible stop along the way. And so that was a bit of an entanglement for a while. But I finally relented, and I'm so glad I did, because you know, she had exquisite taste for everything. Of course, we ate well, even when we were camping. But the tent was this humongous tent. It was like a 10-person tent. So every time we camped, I have to take it out, set it up. And it was just going to be for the evening anyways, but you know, it was quite an ordeal. Pack it up the next day and go. We ended up doing a lot more motels after that, I think. But the highlight of the trip, of course, when we got to the Canadian Rockies, and that's how I realized that she knew what she was talking about, because we traveled from down around Banff and Lake Louise and all that, all through the the ice fields, well, the Canadian Rockies, which are, anybody who's been there knows they're just gorgeous. And that was just a very memorable trip of many trips we had. And but that was the one I did with my mother, just the two of us. So fond memories there. We did end up in British Columbia. We met Charlotte and her family in the mountains. And I finally took the motorcycle off the back with my brother Alex helped me get it off, because that's why it stayed on the car the whole time. There's no way I'd get that thing off. It was a 500 Honda, weighed about 500 pounds, I guess, a pound per cc. But and after that, I did a lot more motorcycle trips, but I didn't take my mom. And I think of so many other stories, but Scott, you got some?
The first thing I want to say is I really want to, you know, acknowledge Steve for all he's done for mom in the last 10 years. It's been really amazing. And Mike, you're a blast, and I'm so glad that you're their pastor, and you did a great presentation. Mm-hmm. I don't have any one story about mom, because I got a million stories about mom, but she was just a great mom, and this is a perfect example of who she was, because this was her glamour shot that she took years ago. She wanted to do glamour shot, because she could have been a model. We think she could have been a model. She was a beautiful woman, bright, strong. Herb married up. Is how we look at it. But she was a really great mom. She really took care of us, our grandchildren. Her grandchildren were like her own children. My wife was like her second daughter, and she just was always accepting of everybody. And just, I think, the joke in the family is the moving around part, you know. And Ben was the first unfortunate one to be the drop off. He was dropped off in Canada, and when they moved down to Cape Cod. Then they went to Cape Cod, then went to Texas, then they came back to Cape Cod, then they went to Texas again, and they left us in Cape Cod, which we really thoroughly enjoy for 47 years. So, but the beach was the big thing. Cape Cod was where they wanted to be, and I'll just tell one quick story, because there's so many, but there's some I can't tell. But Herb got a boat one time, a little 9-foot little whaler boat, and he put a little motor on the back, because he could go down and park in the beach grass, and then just bring the boat down to the little river next to the ocean, and we'd all get in it, and be about this much between the water and the top of the boat. And it'd be like mom, dad, Deb, me, one of them, I think Greg might have been there. He's our oldest. And we'd go to the beach, and the kids would just play and pick up snails all day long and stuff. But we always were scared to death that we'd sink, you know, just getting down the river to get to where the beach was. But that was Herb and Sue. They always took risks. They always, like, were always at the edge. And that's about the River Runt.
Because I'm a Centerville River.
It's the Centerville River. But, no, I have so much gratitude for being the son of Susan, because she was just so amazing, and I think I benefited from that. We all benefited from that immensely.
Okay, I want to counter what Scott said to thank Steve and Debbie for all the care you did with Steve, with Susan. She was a handful, but she was true. Whenever you guys brought people home, she always welcomed them, had food. The more the merrier. She was never really uptight about it. I met her when I was 13, when I started dating Scott. Neither one of us could drive, and my first introduction was legally. She picked me up with Scott in the 63 Ford white Country Squire wagon, and we sat in the back like this and went to his house, and you know, she was just wonderful. And so years went on, we dated, we got married, and she was always there, you know, to welcome me or give me advice. My mother passed in 74, 9 months after we were married, and Susan stepped in, and she was like a second mom. And I'd like to share advice she gave me to you women and daughter-in-laws, and I've passed it to my daughter. She said to me, "I'm going to give you a piece of advice, and you can choose to do with it with what you want." In other words, you know, telling me something, but without, you know, forcing me, you know, to do it. And I've repeated that to Jen, and Jennifer, my daughter, will sometimes say, "Well, I don't think I asked for that," or something smart. But I feel like as the men of Herb's generation were the greatest generation, I feel like she was of that era, the ladies that, you know, went to college, that maintained the home. She did work on and off throughout the house, you know, her life, but she always maintained the home. She cooked, she decorated, you know, she was something to aspire to. And I think, you know, as much as I am sort of towards, you know, with Women's Lib, I think that the art of keeping your home and keeping your children away from a lot of electronics is kind of lost. My daughter is pretty good about that. There's no kid tablets in their house, minimal television. But she made sure everybody did their homework, the clothes were clean, the house was clean, and she was a wonderful mother-in-law. So that's it.
Hello, Charlotte, Raven. Glad you're here. Nice job, Pastor Mike. That was a great rendition of her life. She was a strong person to put up with the four of us. We tried to get away with whatever we could. And again, I took the brunt of it because she knew all the tricks after these three had gotten away with it. So I couldn't get away with much. Couldn't find the chocolate bars or the candy bars that she hid all over the house, and it was tough, but I love her so much. She always took us to baseball games, the football games, later on in hockey. She was always there for me. She never once complained or had anything negative to say. She was always there for us. Yeah, she was quite busy with the four of us. I can't say enough of about how much she took care of us and extended her time for us. I do have a funny story. I've told this a few times. It was, I think I was probably 9-10 years old, living in Eaton's Neck on Long Island. And our grandmother just gotten back from Australia, and she had given us these boomerang gifts. And we had these boomerangs, and one day I was over at a buddy's place, and we were throwing the boomerangs around, and I had thrown it up and got caught in a tree. And Mom was just on her way over to pick me up to take me home, and she drives up in the, I think it was a 64 Chevy Impala convertible. And so she pulls up, and I go, Mom, the boomerang's up in the tree. I can't get it down. She goes, leave it to me. She walks into our friend's garage, comes out with a hammer. She goes, I'll just knock it out of the tree with this hammer. So she goes to throw the hammer back to go and throw it up in the tree to knock the boomerang down, and the head flies off the end of the hammer handle. Goes up in the air, poof, right through the roof of the convertible. And she just calm, didn't say anything. She went over, opened up the door, took the hammer head off the front seat, put it back on it, and did it again. But she got the boomerang out of the tree, came down, and it didn't say a word. She was calm, no problem. And I remember sitting in the front seat going home, looking up at the hole in the roof. And she looked over, and she said, don't worry. It's nothing your dad can't fix with gaffer tape, with duct tape. we got lots of duct tape. And that was dad's fix for just about everything. But yeah, she was a funny person, made us laugh all the time. I'm gonna miss her. Yeah, I love her forever. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
My name is Lee Most, and I lived at the gardens with her, and I met her at Bible study. And she was a fun person, and I'm so glad that Charlotte gave all of that insight and that he gave. And so now I know a little bit more about her and why she was the way she was. Well, I described her as a glitzy lady. Because every time she would come to Bible study, she would have a new pair of pants or such on, and she was just, and Steve said that she kind of liked to go on the computer, and I gathered but I didn't know that she had a boutique at one time. And so now I understand more why she really loved clothes than anything. And Steve shared with me one time she kind of had a little accident, and she ordered a pair of shoes, but instead she got three pair. Was it three?
11.
Well, I thought three was bad, but anyway.
She kept hitting the button on the computer because she didn't think it was working.
And so it gave him an extra job to send him back. But I met Steve by walking down the hall. Because I cared for a lady that lived down on the other end of the hall from where Susan lived. And so we kind of struck up a conversation, and he was going into her apartment. And so from then on, we kind of struck up a conversation because I would walk her in the hall at the same time. And so anyway, that's how I got to know Steve and Debbie. And one time I got to meet Charlotte, and she is love. And I see that, Susan had a glow about her. She had that smile every time she would come into the Bible study. And everybody loved her. Everybody there, they just loved her when she came in the Bible study. And I have to tell you kind of a funny story, about her that I thought was kind of funny. And because we had those ugly ducks that came to the apartment complex, and they were just so messy, and they would, but they congregated outside of her door that she had, an outside door, you know, aside from the hall door indoors. And she, I don't know if she fed those ducks accidentally or on purpose, or, but they would come there all the time to eat. And I'd say, oh, they're so messy. And she'd say, oh, I just love those ducks. I said, they need to pick up those ducks and take them all back to that pond where they have come from. Oh, no, she said, they need to stay here because I enjoy them. And so I thought, okay. So anyhow, we got to be quite close, and when I would walk her home with her walker and come go in and sit down, and we'd visit a little bit, and then later on when she was, she thought she needed to be bedridden, and it was a little bit harder to get in to see her because she either didn't answer her phone when I thought she should, or she was not able to at the time. And anyway, we kind of lost contact with her. But then after she moved out, and she moved over to where she was before she passed, I had a friend from Corpus. I used to live in Corpus. I had a friend that that lived there, and her daughter moved her up here, and they happened to be in the same complex. She was on one wing and Susan was on the other. So I would get to see them all the time. It was hard to get to talk to Susan in latter times because I could never catch her when she was awake. You know, it seemed like, and it was hard to wake her up. But anyway, I prayed with her. I asked her one day about the Lord and did she have Jesus in her heart? And she prayed, and that's a first and the last time that she really had, we had a visible, she was awake and we had a conversation. And that was, I really enjoyed that part of it. And then my friend passed away, and so I didn't get back over there. And then when Steve called me and told me that she had passed and that you were having the service, I was just so blessed to think that he would think of me and invite me. And I told my daughter that I was invited to this. And she said, invited to a funeral? And I said, yes, this is a special, you know, and I thank you all. And you had a lovely mother. She was really special. And my son passed away 12 years ago. So when somebody like Susan passes, I think, I hope that Marv just knew that we were friends and that they would meet each other and have a good time. And so we all have that someone in heaven that's gone ahead of us, and I'm waiting daily to go to be with them. And so I thank you all for sharing your mom with me. God bless you.
Yes. Hi, everybody. I'm Jenny, who is one of Susan's granddaughters. And it's just really nice to hear these things about Grandma that I didn't even know about. Just being from the younger generation. Sorry. But I think Grandma really instilled in me a love of shopping. Clothes. She worked at Jordan Marsh on Cape Cod in the mall, and I remember going, and she worked in the lingerie department. So I remember going as a young lady, and just, you know, I remember just really having fun with her and shopping and going into her walk-in closet at Cape Cod. It was on the lower level of the house, and it was like a hallway. It was humongous, and just playing in her clothes, and It was just really fun. And one of my favorite memories is she was telling me almost exactly, 22 years ago, she said, her, grandpa and I are gonna go to Paris. I was like, oh, wow, grandma, that sounds really fun. I was like, do you need a translator? Because I had been taking French for a number of years, and half joking, but she said, well, sure, yeah. You buy the plane ticket, and don't tell Alexa. It's like, okay, I won't. Sorry, Alexa. I was just there at the right moment, though your French is probably better than mine. But I met them in France, in Paris, at the Hotel Napoléon. It's a beautiful old hotel off of the, right near the Arc de Triomphe, thank you. And I remember I got there before them, and they got a suite, and there was a little settee kind of bed for me, which is really nice. And it was over Mother's Day weekend. Was that 2000, I think? And so there was a little brunch on Mother's Day, the same day, I believe, that we celebrate it. And, we were there kind of late. We're a little tired still. It was maybe like our third or fourth day there. And so there's kind of just the remnants of the buffet. And Herb being Herb and Grandma being Grandma. Oh, Jenny, there's a little bit of goat cheese left. Can you just get that? Like, what do you mean get it? Like, let's bring it back to the room. So I had to go over and to the goat cheese and kind of surreptitiously wrap it in a napkin. And, you need some bread, too. So I had to grab a little bit of bread. And so that was just a memory. I guess apparently I went off a couple times on my own. But, they were older. They wanted to take the bus everywhere, the tour buses. I was like, I want to walk around. So I did a lot of walking and went with them on a few trips. We went to London for a day. And of course, part of that was going off on my own, and me being me, I was late to get back to the train that goes back to France. I probably gave Grandma a couple extra gray hairs because I was very late. But we had a great time. It was really nice to see them in this place where they'd never been, as far as I know. I think that was their first time there, and Grandpa using his French in kind of questionable ways. But no, it was great. We had a great time, and I'm really thankful that they let me go with them. And Grandma and I got to shop and see all the sights, and it was really special to me in that I've been back to France a number of times since, and I always think of my trip with them and how generous it was for them to bring me along. And obviously, I have all the memories of the beach and Cape Cod, and I think Grandma also instilled in me a love of the ocean and being on the beach. And my girls have it too, and they're the ones who get buck naked on the beach in April in Cape Cod. If you've ever been to New England in April, it's not the summer. It's not swimming weather, but we just love it. So thank you, everyone who knew her and loved her. And I'm glad I got to know her for the time that I did. And it's really great to hear these stories and hear about the woman that she was, and not, yes, mother and wife and all that, but also just thinking of her as a person and, not just my grandma. It's just really special, so thank you.
That Steve and Charlotte felt like was particularly appropriate or meaningful to their mom. So, wouldn't miss seeing the pictures and having the memories for anything, but it's hard, isn't it? It's hard to say goodbye, to say farewell to someone that you love so much and that loved you so much. I want to close. We're just going to take just a few minutes, and I want to look at a couple of scripture passages. And as we think about Susan, and as I was talking with her friends, and her coming to terms with mortality, recognizing, as we all do, we are closer to leaving this earth every day, to leaving this life. We were talking earlier, and you know, I get up in the morning, I look in the mirror, and I think there must be some mistake. I don't mind getting old, I just thought it'd take longer, right? But, you know, as Susan came to terms with mortality, with eternity, she was involved with the Bible study with some of the ladies, and she talked to them about Scripture, and she talked to them about what that eternity meant. And as we are looking at that question, Psalm 23 always comes to mind, and in talking with Charlotte, and she gave me a list of scriptures that she thought might be appropriate, and I always like Psalm 23. I want to read that from the New King James Version, where King David, in a time of stress and distress, wrote, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And I was thinking about today and reading that passage, and we always read, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And we talk about the valley of the shadow of death being a valley, and that's what you have to pass through to get from mountaintop to mountaintop. Every bright, sunny, happy place seems to be divided from another one by a darker place, and that shepherd goes with us. And the question is, who is the shepherd? And I think that is what Susan was coming to terms with when her friends were talking with her and were in Bible study with her. So I asked this question. Susan was this loving mother. She perfected the art of the home and cooking and providing. She enjoyed what God gave her in nature and creation and resources and clothes and food and puppy dogs. I now know what a red miniature poodle looks like. So this was a very vibrant, loving person who spent her whole life serving her family. And the question I asked was, this loving mother who loved you so dearly, and grandmother, if she could come back and say one last thing to us, what would she say? What would she tell you as you complete your life and your time on this earth? And what I think she would say is, follow the shepherd. Know the shepherd. Trust the shepherd. Follow the shepherd, because he's got this. He's the one that leads us through the dark times, that gives us comfort when we are in those dark places, that provides restoration and peace for our souls, that gives us comfort when there's not comfort to be had. And in John chapter 10, Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd. I am the one who lays down his life for the sheep. I'm not the hired hand that runs off when something gets tough, but I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." Old Testament tells us that each of us are like sheep, and we tend to go our own ways and do our own thing, even when it gets us into trouble. And Jesus says, who leaves the 99 and goes and finds the one and brings him back and cares for him and takes care of him. The good shepherd is the one that stands us in perfect forgiveness before God, the one that gives us still water and nourishment and refreshment and peace and restoration. And at the end of Psalm 23, it changes from a shepherd to a sheep to us being a guest for a great banquet. You prepare a place for me in the presence of my enemies, that my enemies are hopeless and helpless and have no power, but I am in the presence of the Good Shepherd, enjoying that feast of celebration of being with my God forever. Susan worked her whole life to be fun-loving and faithful wife to Herb. She packed up and moved you guys countless times. She endured hurricanes and floods and moves and trips and then some more trips. But she made sure you guys were involved, that you were provided for, that you had opportunity, that you were out in creation at the beach and enjoying what God made for you. She's a mom that wanted the best for her friends and her kids and her grandkids. And because of that mother's love, I think she would encourage you to seek the best, to seek God's best for you. Trust and follow the Good Shepherd, the one that lays down his life, who searches out the stray, who brings them back just because he cares and loves. Your mother loved you. Your God loves you more. He's got this. I know you're going to miss her. Find comfort in the faith and in the words of the Good Shepherd. He is there to protect you and to give you peace and comfort. You are honoring and remembering Susan Tuttle Griffith very fondly. And as we close, we wish her Godspeed. And in her honor, we seek and we trust the Good Shepherd. Let's pray. Father, we recognize that life is beyond us, that death is a thief, that it robs us of moms and dads, grandmothers, friends. But we recognize that death is not final, but simply a change of address for those that are yours. We pray, Lord, that you would make us right with you, that you would keep us hopeful, that you would give us peace, that you would lead us. We ask, Father, that as you will, we might see Susan again and be reunited with her in your presence. May we trust you to walk us through the times we miss her, the gap it leaves when the memories ambush us. Because you are the Good Shepherd and you care for us beyond our comprehension. Bless us with your presence and with the memories of a life well lived, in the name of Jesus. Amen. So this wraps up down here. All right. I will yield to you, Steve. Okay. Well, we have prepared a reception, some snacks and things upstairs. You're invited to continue to share and to talk and to visit. It was very interesting sitting over here and listening to the comments during the pictures and the memories that you're sharing. So please don't feel like you have to rush off. We're here for you guys. When you go out the foyer, you go out these back doors. The foyer doors are in the corner. There's double doors. Go up those stairs, and the reception room will be right there at the top of the stairs. So, Steve?
love you all, and what better way to honor my mother?